The raids bring only temporary terror to Baghdad. Otherwise, it seems a city peculiarly content to be at war, at least while its own side is winning. Only the foreigners have fled, thousands of them drawn to Iraq for the money, now deciding that a shooting war is no part of the deal. And then there's the chance to join in the war games, to cake your bus with mud so that a telltale glint from burnished metal doesn't betray your position to Iranian warplanes, even if the nearest you get to the front is a city bus stop. Baghdad seems positively to revel in the war. It's almost as if war is a natural state in the bazaars of Baghdad. Certainly the inconvenience of this conflict has so far proved minimal. There's no petrol shortage, and the price is fixed at an envy-making 14 pence a gallon. So vast are their reserves that Iraqis say that the last two barrels of oil in the world will be theirs. A world away from the rigid orthodoxy of the Ayatollahs in Iran, a generation of modern Baghdad women shun the veil. Strolling unconcernedly in city streets in Western clothes, there's a way of life to be defended as well as a country and a regime against the incursions of Iran's puritanical revolution. And so far, the defense of those modern ideals has proceeded well. The face of the man who took the Iraqi people to war gazes out from posters all over Baghdad, Saddam Hussein al-Takriti, president in name for the past 14 months, but Iraq's strongman for the past decade. Variously attired in bespoke lounge suit or as popular hero in Arab headdress, or in the uniform of a field marshal, although he was never a soldier, sometimes depicted as the sweaty labourer with shovel to hand, but his favourite image, the cuddly father figure. The war with Iran has given Iraq a rare opportunity to brush up a pretty tarnished image. A week ago, the government commandeered all 550 beds in this hotel, the largest and the most modern in Baghdad, and then proceeded to fill them with the international press. As the Iraqis see it, the international press can help confer a new status as well as a new image on their country. But that does not mean the foreign press is free in its operations in Iraq. Television teams are tightly monitored in all they film and go to the front only on officially escorted bus tours. The press has now been ordered out of the Shatt al-Arab area altogether, a firm enough indication that the war in the south is not going too well. If it drags on, there could be more pressure on outsiders to intervene. I asked the Iraqi foreign minister what he had to say to the big powers.
There is one thing that we would like to say to the big powers. That is not to interfere in the area in any way, to keep away. Not to interfere directly or indirectly. This has been always what we wanted from the big powers.
Are you confident that Iraq and the smaller Arab countries in the Gulf will be able, though, to maintain security for what are, after all, vital interests, vital economic interests for the West?
Yes, definitely. After all, who is threatening our independence? If it is a country in the region, we should be able to deal with that. But if it is a big power coming and interfering in the area, then the other big power would use that as a pretext for its own interference, and we get in the vicious circle.
There were those, of course, who saw the vicious circle beginning with the Soviet intervention in Afghanistan, that this was a move that, in many ways, it was suggested, directly threatened the Gulf. Now, what's your view of that?
The interference, the military interference of the Soviet Union in Afghanistan was a move which we had a position of. We said our position, we stated our position.
You were opposed to it.
Yes. But we also said that it should not be used as a pretext for an American interference in the area. It should not be used as a cover for a military coming back by the United States in the area. Apparently, the United States is not listening. They are spending efforts to come back in sort of naval and military facilities in Oman and Somalia. We believe that would instead of coping with the situation that would only aggravate the situation.
With the collapse of Iran as a military power, don't you foresee Iraq playing a larger role in the security of this region?
We are not involved in the security of regions in the way people speak about in the Western press. We have security responsibilities for the Arab countries. I don't know what do you mean by the region. Iran is responsible for its own security. Every country is responsible for its own national security. If there is any collective security which Iraq is a part of, that's the Arab collective security. Otherwise, I really don't know what is meant by regional security.
Well, we're obviously referring to the Gulf and your plans to expand the Iraqi Navy, for instance, surely suggest a rather larger role within the Gulf waters, within...
To protect our independence, to protect the independence of the Arab homeland, so that we would not have a second case of the three islands. You know, the Shah just came and occupied the three islands. No one could do anything. It's part of our homeland. He just occupied that. We don't like to have such a situation repeated again.
So you are saying then, Minister, that there has been a decisive shift in the balance of power in this area. If you have no intention of ever letting that sort of thing happen again.
We would like to protect the independence of Iraq. Any other Arab country on the Arabian Gulf, if its independence is threatened and we are asked to assist, we will assist. We feel that is our responsibility. That's the only responsibility we have in the area.
That you would come to the aid of any smaller Arab country in the Gulf, for instance?
Yes.
Whether it had a problem with, a military problem with Iran or any other country?
If it is an Arab country, no. A foreign country, yes.
And in this region, that is likely, surely, to be the Iranians principally, isn't it?
It has been for the last 500 years. The threat always came from Iran.